Hello friends and welcome to Digimento. So today we will be taking up this chapter, Natural Hazards and Disasters, Mitigation Strategies. So we were already dealing with this chapter and till yesterday we have completed the Natural Hazards and Disasters, and today we will be discussing about the National Disaster Management Act. Okay. So I hope you have joined the lectures with me now. If you have not yet come, please do come fast, and those who are already watching, please do send me a hi hello so that we will just start with. So if you are watching this lecture, please do send me a hi so that we will be able to start now, start immediately. Hi Rani, hi Senthil, only two. So where are the others? So we will just immediately start as soon as like 4 or 5 people join the class. Hi Lipika. Anybody else who have joined, please do let me know so that we will immediately start the class. And today we will take a little longer. Not today, actually, from today onwards we will go a little longer because the exam dates are announced. You might be aware of that. So exam dates are already announced. It will start from 16th of September. So it's hardly one more month to go, not even a month to go. So we have a lot to cover in that small period of time, and you also have to revise and study and all that. So we will extend the sessions a little more. Maybe otherwise we were taking like 35 to 40 minutes. So now I'll try to take at least 50 to 55 minutes lectures. Maybe it will go up to 1 hour also. Hi Sumati, good evening. So yeah, I think we will just start with, let the others come and join in between. So we will just start with, okay, without wasting much time, we will start. And this is our channel, and if you have not yet subscribed to our channel, please do subscribe. And also if you are preparing for GATE, NTA, UGC NET or PGT Computer Science, you can avail our online courses. You can visit our website www.digimentor.com, or you can call to this number to get more details about the courses that we provide. So we were dealing with natural hazards and disasters. You can quickly go through, just take 1 minute or 2 minutes maximum to simply go through whatever we have learned till yesterday. By that time others will also join, and after others join we will start with the new topic that we will start today. So you can just go through. Okay, I'll change the slide so that you can just revise and go. Don't take more than 2 minutes. I'll not even take more than 2 minutes for this recap. Cyclone, cyclonic storms, different types of cyclones that hit the Indian coast recently. Mitigation strategies, drought, meteorological drought, hydrological, agricultural, ecological. Then the mitigation strategies of drought. Earthquake, then earthquake waves, body waves, surface waves, P waves and S waves. Measurement, zones, the mitigation strategies. You can use it for revision, okay? You can just glance through. So exam is nearby, you can use it for revision. Even if you don't get time at your home, you can use this time for revision. Floods, India's flood prone areas, mitigation strategies. Landslide, mitigation strategy. Tsunamis also we discussed yesterday, mitigation strategies. Volcanic eruption, Now we will come to Disaster Management Act of 2005. So I want to know whoever is watching my video now, send me a hi, hello. Okay. Anyway, we will start now. We don't have much time left. Already the exam dates are announced. So I think we will go a little faster now. Most of you are expecting the exams to be held in November or December, but it will be held in September. So we will just see, we will finish our part. Okay, hi Pavitra. So we will just start with today's portion. So today we will be discussing about the Disaster Management Act of 2005. So Disaster Management Act, this is a statutory act, which means it is passed by the parliament. So it is a statute, or it is statutory in nature. So statutory in nature, and it came into force in the month of January 2016. So after 1 year of its passing, it was implemented in 2006. Now the objective of the act is to manage the disasters, including the preparation of mitigation strategies and capacity building. So the objective of this act is to manage the disasters, including the preparation of mitigation strategies and the capacity building. Okay, and it provides establishment of National Disaster Management Authority, that is the NDMA. It provides for the establishment of NDMA, National Disaster Management Authority, with the Prime Minister of India as the chairperson. This is important. Questions may be asked, who is the chairperson of the Disaster Management Authority? So NDMA. Now the National Disaster Management Authority, it has been established under the Disaster Management Act of 2005. So Disaster Management Act of 2005, it's a statutory act, or it's a legislation passed by the parliament to manage the disasters. And inside that, it includes the preparation of mitigation strategies and capacity building to manage the disasters. And the Disaster Management Act of 2005, it provides for the establishment of National Disaster Management Authority at the national level. So this will be the apex authority to take care and to manage the disasters. The chairperson of the National Disaster Management Authority will be the Prime Minister. Okay. And the act enjoins the central government to constitute a national executive committee. Apart from the National Disaster Management Authority, the act also empowers the central government in order to constitute a national executive committee, NEC, to assist the national authority. National authority is the National Disaster Management Authority. So in order to help the NDMA, the central government can also establish a national executive committee. So national executive committee will be responsible for assisting the National Disaster Management Authority, NDMA. Now coming to the state level, all the state governments are mandated to establish a state disaster management authority. So the state governments should be establishing a state disaster management authority, or an SDMA. At the national level, we have the NDMA. At the state level, there should be a SDMA, or the state disaster management authority. Now, section 25 of the DM Act, section 25 of the Disaster Management Act provides for constitution of DDMA, constitution of disaster, district disaster management authority, for every district of a state. So again, now we will see, at the apex level we have the NDMA, which is at the national level. Now SDMA is mandatory. State Disaster Management Authority has to be established by the state government, and it is mandatory under the act. Then also we have the section 25. So section 25 of the Disaster Management Act provides for the constitution of DDMA, or the District Disaster Management Authority. So DDMA, District Disaster Management Authority. District Disaster Management Authority has to be constituted at the district level. Okay. Now let's come to the National Disaster Management Authority, NDMA. Let's see the details. It is the apex statutory body. Now, what is meant by a statutory body? A statutory body means a body which is established according to a statute. Now, what is a statute? Statute means it is a legislation passed by the parliament. So, statutory body means a body which attains its power, or which gains its power from the statute or a legislation passed by the parliament. This is called a statutory body. So NDMA or the National Disaster Management Authority is the statutory, apex statutory body for disaster management in India. It was constituted on 27th of September 2006. So we saw that the National Disaster Management Act was passed in 2005 and it was implemented in 2006. So the National Disaster Management Authority was constituted for the first time in September 2006 and Prime Minister is the chairman. This is very important. So Prime Minister is the chairman of the Disaster Management Authority, National Disaster Management Authority, and there are 9 other members and one such member to be designated as the vice chairperson. So there are 9 other members, that means Prime Minister acting as the chairperson plus 9 members, that is total of 10 members. So out of this 9 other members, one person shall be designated as the vice president of this authority. Okay. Next, apex, it is the apex body to lay down the policies, plans and guidelines for the disaster management to ensure timely and effective response to the disasters. So NDMA, the National Disaster Management Authority, will act as the apex body, that is the ultimate body or the highest body, to lay down policies, plans and the guidelines. So it lays down the policies regarding disaster management, the plans for disaster management and the guidelines for the disaster management to ensure timely and effective response to disasters. And it is also responsible to build a safer and disaster resilient India by holistic, proactive, technology driven and sustainable development strategy. So these are the things to be kept in mind while designating or while framing the policies. So a safer and disaster resilient India should be built. Now this should be based on the policies for building a disaster resilient India or a safer country should be based on the policies of holistic. Holistic means overall approach, proactive, technology driven and sustainable development. So we have already discussed about sustainable development. So these are the various things which has to be kept in mind by the authority while making the decisions. Now coming to the functions and responsibilities of NDMA, National Disaster Management Authority, to approve the National Disaster Plan. So first one, it approves the National Disaster Plan. So a plan made at the national level has to be finally approved by the NDMA to lay down the policies on disaster management, to approve plans prepared by the central government. Plans prepared by the central government, which means the plans regarding disaster management. So those plans relating to disaster management prepared by the central government, to lay down the guidelines to be followed by the state authorities in drawing up a state plan. So to lay down the guidelines which has to be followed by the state authorities in drawing up a state plan. We have discussed about the State Disaster Management Authority. So when the State Disaster Management Authority makes plans with regard to disaster management, the guidelines for that should be given by the National Disaster Management Authority. It also lays down the guidelines to be followed by the central government for the purposes of integrating the measures for disaster prevention or mitigation of its effect in their development plans and projects. Next is to coordinate enforcement and implementation of disaster management policy and plan. That is coordinating enforcement and implementation of disaster management policy and plan. Next is to recommend the provision of funds for the purpose of mitigation. So how much funds has to be allocated for the purpose of mitigation? It is recommended by the Disaster Management Authority, National Disaster Management Authority. Now here very important is that Prime Minister is the chairman, therefore definitely it is an executive decision. So Prime Minister being a member of the Council of Ministers, or not just member, head of the Council of Ministers, definitely this is an executive decision. to provide such support to other countries which are affected by major disasters as determined by the central government. To provide support to other countries which are affected by major disasters. So, we have seen different examples in the current affairs in the newspapers recently. Also, like for example, if there is any disaster in our neighboring countries, especially smaller countries, India will send its army, navy, military forces. Again, medical supplies, etc. are given by India. So, this is because it is the commitment of our country to take care of our neighbors. And we also have adopted the policy of neighborhood first. So, the Prime Minister has announced that our foreign relations policy will stand at this principle of neighborhood first policy. So, also this NDMA, National Disaster Management Authority, will provide such support which are needed by the other countries as decided by the central government. Next is to take such other measures for the prevention of disasters. That is to take measures with regard to prevention of disasters or mitigation or preparedness and capacity building for dealing with threatening disaster situation or disaster as it may consider necessary. So, prevention and preparedness, and also capacity building to deal with threatening disaster situation. To lay down broader policies and guidelines for the functioning of National Institute of Disaster Management. So, how the National Institute of Disaster Management, National Institute of Disaster Management, how it has to function, it is also decided by the National Disaster Management Authority. So, this is all about this chapter. We have finished it, but we are not stopping it here today. We will take up the next chapter because we don't have much time. The exam is scheduled on 16th, from 16th onwards. So, we do not have much time. So, we will be taking up the next chapter also now. Okay. So, hi Neetu and hi Puvidi. So, I think this much is clear for you. If you have any doubts from this chapter, you can put it now. I'll just wait for 1 minute. And we will just start with the next chapter, that is the chapter 6. Okay. If you have any doubts, put it now. We will discuss that and then we will move to the next chapter. We do not have much time, and I'm planning that from the next week onwards, maximum by Tuesday or Wednesday, we will start with the previous year questions. So we have to finish before that. Pooja is asking me, Hindi mein bhi baat diya karo. Okay, I'm not very comfortable, but still I'll try. Okay. So, yeah. We don't have much time. So, please ask me your doubts. And then if it's clear for you, then mention that also. So that we will move ahead. Clear. Okay, so shall we move to the next chapter? Okay, because we have very less time, I think we have to just take up the next chapter. Okay. Okay, so it's clear. So next chapter is chapter 6, the 6th one. So we have just 6th and 7th, then we will finish this unit. Okay, the 6th chapter is natural and energy resources. So here we will be specifically discussing about solar energy, wind energy, soil, then hydro, geothermal, biomass, nuclear energy, and the forest. So, yeah. So, we will just start with India's renewable energy target. So we have set up a renewable energy target of 175 gigawatts. So this is the Prime Minister's target. So this is the target set by Prime Minister that by the year 2022, we will be achieving a 175 gigawatts of renewable energy. If you can recollect, we have already discussed about the difference between renewable energy and non-renewable energy. So renewable energy is the energy that we can renew or replenish. So the energy sources which can be renewed or replenished over a period of time. So they are called the renewable energy. So by 2022, we have the target of 175 gigawatts of renewable energy. So out of this, again, the split is like this. 5 gigawatt will be from small hydro projects. That means smaller projects like small dams and all. Then 10 gigawatt will be from biomass. 40 gigawatt from rooftop solar. 60 gigawatt from solar photovoltaic. And then 60 gigawatt from wind. So here we will see that out of 175 gigawatts, 100 gigawatts will be from solar energy. So solar energy is the main source of renewable energy that we are looking upon or that we are depending upon. Now let's continue. So we will just start with solar energy because we have understood the relevance and the importance of solar energy to achieve this target of 175 gigawatts of renewable energy by 2022. So there are two ways by which we can produce electricity from the sunlight. Solar energy is basically the sunlight. Okay. So there are basically two ways through which we can produce the electricity from sunlight. First one is photovoltaic electricity. So this is the first one. Second one is solar thermal energy. So these are the two ways by which we can produce electricity from the sunlight. So photovoltaic electricity, it uses the photovoltaic cells that absorb the direct sunlight to generate electricity. So in the first category, which is the photovoltaic electricity, the cells, have you heard about solar cells? This is what is called the photovoltaic cells. There was an issue that we were importing the solar cells from China. So using the photovoltaic cells that absorb the direct sunlight. So the solar cells will absorb the sunlight directly and then generate electricity. Then we also have solar thermal energy, which uses solar collector that has a mirrored surface which reflects the sunlight into a receiver that helps heat up a liquid, and this heated up liquid is used to make steam that will produce electricity. So this is an indirect method. The first one is a direct method. By using photovoltaic cells, directly the sunlight can be converted into electricity. The second method is solar thermal energy, solar thermal electricity, where it uses a solar collector. So solar collector which has a mirrored surface. So a mirrored surface solar collector which reflects the sunlight into a receiver, and this receiver heats up a liquid, and this heated liquid is used to make steam, and from there it produces electricity. Okay, this is the second method. Now we will come to the National Solar Mission. So it was earlier named as Jawaharlal Nehru National Solar Mission. So National Solar Mission, it has a target of 20,000 megawatts of grid connected solar power by 2022. So National Solar Mission has set up a target of 20,000 megawatts of grid connected solar power by 2022. And it was revised in June 2015 to 100 gigawatts by 2022. Now again we have this overall renewable energy 175 gigawatts, and we have discussed about the split. So when we discussed about the split, we discussed that out of this 100 gigawatts will be contributed by solar energy. Okay, so this is the National Solar Mission. By 2022, we have to achieve 100 gigawatts. All these facts are very important for your examination. they can ask you, so what is the target? 100 gigawatts. So we have the target of achieving 100 gigawatts of solar energy by the year 2022. The 100 gigawatt solar power capacity, this has been divided into two. So we have already discussed the split in the beginning. 100 gigawatt is split into two, divided into two. First one is rooftop solar electricity generation, and target is 40 gigawatts. Next is large and medium scale grid connected solar projects, and the target is 60 gigawatts. Okay, so this is the target. Now, very important is International Solar Alliance, because in your syllabus this has been explicitly mentioned about International Solar Alliance, and you can expect questions from that. So ISA, or the International Solar Alliance, this is a initiative which is proposed by India and France at the UN Climate Change Conference in Paris. So India proposed it. India along with France proposed this International Solar Alliance. So we can say that India is a founding member of this alliance, and it was launched in 2015, November 30th. Now, what is ISA, or what is International Solar Alliance? So International Solar Alliance of the it is an alliance of the countries lying in between two tropics, that is Tropic of Cancer and Tropic of Capricorn. So I will just show you one second. I'll just remove, okay, and I show you. Okay, because I'm writing with the mouse, it's not very clear. Suppose this is the Earth, and here the borders are a little flattened, that is why we call it as geoid. The shape of the Earth is geoid. Now equator divides the Earth into two equal halves. So equator lies at 0 degree. Okay, then we have this Tropic of Cancer. Okay, equator divides the Earth into two equal halves. One is the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere. India lies in the northern hemisphere. Okay, now again on the northern hemisphere we have the Tropic of Cancer. So this is the Tropic of Cancer. So this lies at 23 degree. Then here we have the, so on southern hemisphere we have Tropic of Capricorn, again at 23 degree. Then again we have the Arctic Circle, and here we have the Antarctic Circle. So both Arctic Circle is in the northern hemisphere, and here we have the Antarctic Circle. So both of them lies at 66 degrees. So this is how it is. Now we know that equator, so those countries which are near to the equator, they receive more of the sunlight. So equator. Now this is the Tropic of Cancer and the Tropic of Capricorn. So those countries which lies between the Tropic of Cancer and Tropic of Capricorn, so these countries are called the solar rich countries. Why? Because they are close to the equator and they receive maximum sunlight or solar energy. So they receive the maximum sunlight. Therefore these countries are called solar rich countries or sunlight rich countries. So this ISA, International Solar Alliance, this is an alliance of the countries which lies between the two tropics, that is the Tropic of Cancer and the Tropic of Capricorn. Okay, Tropic of Capricorn is in the southern hemisphere and Tropic of Cancer is in the northern hemisphere. Okay, now where is the position of India? Now if we have to see the position of India, this is the equator. Sorry, okay, I'll just, okay, I'll just show you on an map of India rather than drawing the Earth. Okay, so Tropic of Cancer. So Tropic of Cancer passes through almost middle of the country. So half of the country lies, or more than half of the country lies between the Tropic of Cancer and the equator. Okay, So, Tropic of Cancer divides our country into almost two halves, not halves actually, passes through the middle, we can say. So, therefore, India is also a solar rich country. So, India and France has initiated the International Solar Alliance, and India is also a founding member of the International Solar Alliance. Okay, I hope this much is clear for you. Now, what are the main aims or the objectives of International Solar Alliance? So, International Solar Alliance has this important objectives. One is reducing the financial risk across a larger global market. So, why financial risk? Because the renewable energy resources like the solar energy, it can be renewed and it comes at low cost at the long run. Second one, ensuring cooperation on technology. So, those countries which are the members of the ISA, International Solar Alliance, so these countries can ensure the cooperation on technology, and better technology can be leveraged in order to make use of the solar energy. Next is access, energy access, increasing the energy access. Then next one is the building of capacity. So these are the main aims of International Solar Alliance. So this is about the International Solar Alliance. If you have any doubts, then I will clarify. So please put your doubts in the comment section. So we will clarify the doubts and then move on. Okay, repeat the aims of ISA. First one is to reduce the financial risk. Why financial risk? Because for example, if India alone, so if India alone is trying to leverage the solar power, then what will happen? India has to develop the technology by itself, then India has to bear all the expenses by itself. Now it's an alliance, International Solar Alliance. There are many countries who are the members, so they will share the cost among themselves, and therefore the cost of leveraging the solar energy will come down. Second one related to this is that since solar energy is a renewable energy, once the technology development has been made, then after that the cost will be very less. So financial risk is very less. Second one is to build capacity. So capacity building with regard to solar energy leverage. So solar energy leverage, the capacity building is the second aim. Third one is ensuring the cooperation on technology. Like as I said, because of the alliance of different countries, especially if there are many countries which has technological advantages, so the technological know-how, etc., so this cooperation will help in ensuring that there is a sharing of the technology. Next is increasing the energy access. So access to energy will improve or increase. So these are the aims. If it's clear, please tell me, Neetu. Any other doubts, you can ask me. Clear. Okay. Now, any other doubts? Clear. And what about others? If it's clear, please tell me. Any other doubts? I hope no. Shall I continue? Clear. Okay, so I think we will continue. Next is a wind energy. I know I'm going a bit faster because your exam dates are announced and we have hardly 1 month to go. So I have to finish the entire syllabus and previous year questions as well. So that is why I'm going a little faster. So, okay, it's clear. Now, wind energy, it is a kinetic energy which is associated with the movement of atmospheric air. So, wind is the movement of atmospheric air, and the kinetic energy which is associated with the movement of atmospheric air is called the wind energy. Now, wind turbines. So, wind turbines transform the energy into in the wind into the mechanical power, further converting the mechanical power into electric power to generate the electricity. So basically the wind turbines, the turbines transform the energy in the wind. So when there is a movement of air, definitely it carries some energy. So this energy is converted into mechanical power by the wind turbines. So this energy is converted into mechanical power and then further it is converted into electric power. So, electric power in order to generate the electricity. So, this is how the wind energy is generated. Now, let's discuss about the wind farms. So, wind farm is a group of wind turbines. Maybe you have seen wind turbines or wind farms. So, wind farms, it is a group of wind turbines in the same location used for the production of energy, electricity. So, most of you must have seen wind farms, at least in the movies or in the TV or in the internet, on YouTube or anything. So, wind farm means it's a group of wind turbines which are located in the same location for the production of electricity. And we have onshore wind farms. So, onshore wind farms, they operate on land where the wind tends to be the strongest. So, onshore wind farm means those wind farms which operate on the land, and it is where the wind are the strongest. And the turbines on a onshore wind farm are less expensive and easier to set up. So it's less expensive and easier to set up, and they maintain and operate than offshore turbines. So offshore turbines are little difficult to maintain and operate. So these are the advantages of onshore wind farms. Maybe you will get questions to compare the onshore and the offshore wind farms. So onshore means they operate on land, and here the wind is the strongest, it is less expensive, and also maintenance and operation is easier here onshore. Next we have the offshore wind farm. Here the construction of wind farms in large bodies of water. So here the wind farms are constructed on large water bodies for generating the electricity. The offshore wind farms are more expensive than the onshore wind farms of the same nominal power. So it's more expensive. And here the wind energy target, we have discussed that by 2022 the government has a target of 175 generating 175 gigawatts of renewable energy, and out of this 100 gigawatts has to be generated from solar resource. And the wind energy targets, sorry, this is not 2022, this is 2030, I think. Okay, so 60 gigawatts by 2022, and by 2030 it is 200 gigawatt. So this is the wind energy target. Sorry, this is a mistake, it's 2030. Okay. Now we will discuss about the National Offshore Wind Energy Policy. So, National Offshore Wind Energy Policy of 2015. So, offshore is on the water bodies. Okay, onshore is on land and offshore is on the water bodies. So, Ministry of New and Renewable Energy is the nodal agency for the implementation of National Offshore Wind Energy Policy of 2015, and it paves the way for offshore wind energy development, including setting up of offshore wind power projects and research and developmental activities. So the National Offshore Wind Energy Policy of 2015, it aims to create or develop setting up of offshore wind power projects. So offshore wind power projects and research and developmental activities. So next is hydropower. I think we will discuss hydropower also, then we will wind up, okay? It's very simple, it's very easy. That's why I'm moving a little faster. So, hydropower, this power is captured when the water flows downward from a higher level to a lower level, which is then used to turn the turbine. So, in case of dams, dams is a very good example of hydropower. So, what happens? The water flows downward from a higher level to a lower level. So, like this, from higher level to a lower level, then this power or this energy is used to turn the turbine, thereby converting the kinetic energy of water into mechanical energy to drive the generator. And this is the cheapest and the cleanest source of energy, and that is why we have maximum hydropower projects. So cheapest and the cleanest source of energy. So hydropower, it's the cheapest and the cleanest source of energy. Neetu is asking my by 2030 wind energy target, 200 gigawatts. So, this is about the hydropower. Hydropower is generated when water flows downward from a higher level to a lower level. And this is used to turn the turbine, converting the kinetic energy into the mechanical energy. Okay. Then small hydropower. So, hydropower project which has an installed capacity of less than 25 megawatt. This is called a small hydropower. Small hydropower means small hydropower projects which has an installed capacity of less than 25 megawatts. And in most cases, runoff river projects are an example of small hydropower. And India and China are the major players of small hydropower sector. So, India and China, they are the major players of the small hydropower sector, and they hold the highest number of installed projects. So they have the highest number of installed projects. Next we have the ocean thermal energy. So do you want me to continue, or do you want to wind up now? So yes, I'll give you all the PPTs. What I told sir is that because there are so many channels, I am getting confused. So I told sir that I will send them and they will upload it on all the channels. Okay. So do you want me to continue, take up one or two more? Okay, continue. Okay. So next we have the ocean thermal energy. Now, how is ocean thermal energy generated? This is generated because of the temperature differences. The temperature differences between surface of the ocean and the depths of the ocean. So, on the surface and depth, in the depth of the ocean, the temperature is different. And this temperature differences is used to produce the ocean thermal energy. So, the depth of about 1000 meters, that is 1 kilometers, this temperature differences used to operate a heat engine which produces the electric power. Now, can you tell me on the surface or deep ocean, where will be the temperature high? Whether the temperature will be high on the surface or whether the temperature will be high on the depths of the ocean? Lipika has commented that I'm looking good in specs. Thank you, Lipika. I had specs already, but I was not using, and now I have frequent headaches because I'm not using it and I'm always exposed to this laptop and devices. So I started getting headache again. So I started using again. Thank you, Lipika. So where the temperature will be high, depth or surface? Pooja has commented depth. Okay, let's wait for some other answers also. Surface, Neetu, Ashwati also surface. Okay, can you tell me the reason also? Pooja, don't worry, you made a very good attempt, but the answer is otherwise. Surface. It's surface. Why? Because in the surface of the ocean, what happens? The direct rays of the sunlight is received. So it is on the surface of the ocean that the direct sun rays are received. So surface is warm, whereas the depths of the ocean, it's very cold. Okay. So it is the surface of the ocean where the temperatures are high. So this is about the pressure increases, temperature decreases. Yes, correct. Yes. that is also there. But direct sun rays are received on the surface. Next, we will also discuss about wave energy. Then we will wind up. Okay. Wave energy. The wave energy, it results from the interaction of wind with the surface of the sea. So this is wave energy. So as a result of wind, that is the movement of air. So wind is the movement of air. The interaction of wind with the surface of the sea and represent a transfer of energy from wind to the sea. So, wave energy represents a transfer of energy from wind to the sea. The movement of air, it carries some energy and this is transferred to the sea. Another fact regarding this is that the first wave energy project with a capacity of 150 megawatts was first set up at Vizhinjam, which is near Trivandrum. Okay, this is in the district of Trivandrum in Kerala. So this was the first wave energy project which was set up in India and has a capacity of 150 megawatts. So this is a fact relating to it. So with this, we will wind up today's session. And if you have any doubts, please do ask me. I'll wait for some minutes. And if not, we will continue tomorrow. We will try to cover this chapter tomorrow itself. We will try to cover maximum tomorrow and day after tomorrow. So maximum in two classes, maximum tomorrow itself, we will try to cover this module, this chapter. Okay. So I'll try to finish it off as early as possible. I think today is Friday. So Saturday and Sunday, we will finish this chapter for sure. Monday and Tuesday, maybe the last chapter, and then we will go to the previous year question papers. Okay. Unit 10 also we will simultaneously take up. So I hope it's clear for you. If it's clear also, let me know. And if you have liked the video, please share this video with your friends and like the video, and also tell your friends to subscribe to our channel. So I hope it's clear. So let me know if it's clear for you. If you have any doubts, let me know. Okay. So share this video with your friends. It will be helpful for them. We have hardly 1 month to go for your exam. So you have to prepare more thoroughly and rigorously. So make your own timetable. Maybe you can set daily targets, weekly targets, and the entire 1 month target and all. So do your preparations very well. Okay, Lipika has asked me about the tropical part of ISA, International Solar Alliance. I'll just explain it again once more for you. PDF we will definitely provide. So yeah, I'll just explain the tropical part. Okay. So we have the Earth. So the Earth is in a geoid shape, which means the borders are flattened. So this borders of the Earth, they are flattened. So the Earth is divided into two by the equator. So equator passes through the center or the middle of the Earth, which is at 0 degree. So here I'll write this side, 0 degree equator. Okay. Then again, we have, okay. So don't see the line and all. Just understand that at 23 degree, we have the Tropic of Cancer on the Northern Hemisphere, and we have the Southern Hemisphere where at 23 degree, we have the Tropic of Capricorn. Okay. So this area between the Tropic of Cancer in the Northern Hemisphere and Tropic of Capricorn in the Southern Hemisphere is referred as the tropical area. So this the countries which fall either partly, India partly falls within this, because we said half of India is within this, out and half is outside. North India is outside this. So countries which fall either partly or fully into this tropical region, they are a part of the International Solar Alliance. Okay, why? Because these countries between the Tropic of Cancer and Tropic of Capricorn, they receive the maximum sunlight. That is the reason. Okay, so I hope this is clear now. Okay, everyone has commented. Pranav, Neetu, Ashwati, everyone has commented that it's clear. And Pooja, I'll definitely provide the PPT. Sumati, definitely I'll provide you the PPTs. Don't worry about it. Okay, so we will wind up the session today and I'll see you again tomorrow. Take care. Good night.